Darkness tries to hide and trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great.
Good morning. Welcome to the Soto United Methodist Church. We've got several announcements that you'll find in the bulletin for today and the upcoming week. As you look through those, is there anything that we may have missed? Anything that we need to emphasize on there? Looks like they're pretty well covered. Pastor?
Good morning. Welcome to the Soto United Methodist Church. My name is Pastor Young Jin Kim. He says, great morning. Best morning ever to worship God, right? You did best choice. You made the best choice ever this morning. So the theme of this Sunday is passionate worship. Okay? So I'd like to encourage you, show our God what the passion of worship is like. Today. Are you ready?
Yeah.
So we changed a little bit of the worship order. So we will sing three songs, and some of you might be familiar with this song. So it's about grace, amazing grace, and then it connects to the My Chains Are Gone. So, you know, we have our own agenda in our lives. We have our own pain, our suffering, our joy, and everything. But we come here because we believe in Jesus Christ and we believe His grace upon us. We are saved not by our work or what we do, but by only grace. So that's only reason that we are saved and we become God's children. So in that, having that grace and then joy upon us, let us please join us singing, praising our Lord, amazing grace.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I am found, was blind.
Amazing grace, the Lord Christ.
The Lord,
Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. Now I'd like to invite you to pray for the world that so many people are suffering from the natural disaster as you maybe watch the news. Please pray for the victims and then the restoration and then recovery for the towns and the people. And around the world, there are so many floods, and earthquake and wildfire and so many disasters. So we need to pray for them. And please pray for each one of us so that we can become actual true worshipers before God, not spectators or audience or a critic for the worship, but we came here this morning to worship God our Lord, right? So please pray for each one of you to focus on God only. Okay, so Jim will lead us to pray.
As we read in unison, Heavenly Father, thank you for calling us to worship and honor you this morning. We praise you for your love endures forever. We honor you for your grace is greater than our sins. We sing to you for you have kept your promise of Emmanuel, God with us. As we worship you all together, meet each one of us in person through the Holy Spirit. Touch our lives to turn to you and guide us to be fruitful disciples of Jesus. In his holy name we pray. Amen.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for calling us to worship and honor you this morning more than anything else in the world. Help us only focus on you, setting aside all the concerns, worries, burdens, or pride in our lives. Prepare our hearts to be filled with the Holy Spirit, welling up with the living water. Talk to us and open our ears so that we can hear your voice. Equip us to be better disciples of Jesus as we have our pilgrim journey every day. We also pray for those whose names are on our prayer list, those in our thoughts, and those we are not aware of. We hear a lot of news about many kinds of natural disasters like flood, wildfire, earthquake, hurricane, deadly heat, and so on. Mend the victims' wounds, provide them with what they need, and please use us as your hands and feet to do something for them. Heal those sick, ill, and injured physically and also mentally. Open doors to those who are beginning a new life. Befriend the lonely and shine your light upon those who are in darkness of addiction or depression and anxiety. As our community is changing, keep us all safe. Prepare us to welcome our new neighbors as a loving family of faith. Send us to our family, friends, and neighbors as your hands and feet for changing lives, transforming the community by reaching, welcoming, and engaging. We pray all this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now, Sabrina.
Good morning, friends. It's good to see you all this morning here in worship. We are here in the sanctuary in worship this morning, and we are going to hear about that in our scripture verse, and it's very brief. So I want you to put your listening ears on as Mr. Walker reads our scripture today.
From John chapter 4, verse 24. God is spirit, and it is necessary to worship God in spirit and truth.
Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Thanks be to God.
Amen. All right, so it is necessary to worship God in spirit and truth. And we are here worshiping God this morning. And what was the first thing that we did when Mr. Bill and Pastor Kim were up here with their guitars? What were we doing? We were singing. That's one of the ways that we worship God. We are showing our praise and giving our praise and thanks to God. And so this morning, what's another way we worship? Oh, you guys had a parade this morning in Sunday school to praise God. And dancing is another way. What's another way we can praise God and worship? Ooh, we can celebrate our baptism every time we go swimming. Amen. Yes, at the pool. Yes, that's a great way to worship God. So this morning, I am going to show you how we can praise God by saying, wow. So if you hold your three of your fingers up on both sides of your face and make a big O with your mouth, you can make the word wow. So, let's praise God. On the count of three, I want you all to say your favorite kind of animal, okay? And then after you say it, then we'll all say wow, okay? All right, one, two, three. Yeah. Elephant. All right, let's all say wow.
Wow!
Okay, and what about nature? Maybe you like to climb trees, or you like to investigate bugs, or you enjoy flowers, or just the sunset, or a rainbow. Okay, so on three, say your favorite thing about nature, and then we'll all say wow. Okay, ready? One.
Wow!
Okay, and awesome. And we have this amazing church family. So let's say,
wow!
And God created our whole family, and God created all of us. So let's say,
wow!
Good job, good job. So that wow word is a powerful word, and it's a way that we can worship God. We can show God our thanks and our praise this morning. And you all already have been doing that and have some great ways to do it, not just inside, but also outside. All right, and so we are going to get to praise God by singing our song in just a second. But before we do that, we're going to do a prayer, and we're going to do a wow prayer. So instead of an echo prayer, I'm going to say something, and then I want you to say wow as we praise God for it, okay? Are you ready to say wow? Okay, here we go. Dear God, for sky and seas,
wow!
For flowers and trees.
Wow!
For great and small.
Wow!
God, you made it all.
Wow!
And we all agreed, so we said together, amen. All right, let's keep praising God as we sing.
To live with him someday. Please keep praying for our future of our church and the community and the world. And Shelley Coker will dedicate the special music, Love Was When, on behalf of all of us. Thank you. Amen. Thank you, Shelley. Last Sunday, my phone decided to swim. So I did my best to CPR, to resuscitate the phone, and I tried to dry it and put it in a rice bag for more than 24 hours and then open it up and still water moisture in it and then dry it again and then put it in a charger. And then it was like I turned it on, then I saw the galaxy mark, and then I heard one last pulse and then it passed away. I didn't bury it yet, still in my heart, but I honestly, first 2 days, I felt freedom, you know, I was free, you know, but, you know, after that, I was like, it was inconvenient because I couldn't use the navigation, and I couldn't see the calendar whenever I wanted. But after that, I began to be worried about it. You know, am I missing something? Am I missing some text or call, phone call? And I did. I did miss several phone calls, very important. And then missed many text messages, and then you know, couldn't see the calendar, check the calendar. And then communication-wise, with the congregation and then with my family, I felt disconnected. You know, in 21st century nowadays, cell phone was a tool of connection, right? And I realized that very hard way. You know, worship, and then I thought about today's theme that it exactly talks about, tells about us about worship. Worship is the tool of connection between God and us and with all of us. So I hope many of you already began to read this book. We are reading this book together as a church from Sunday school children and youth group and then adult Sunday school and all congregation. I encourage you to read this book. And then Sunday school kids are studying this same book as well. And in this book, Bishop Robert Schneis says like this, passionate worship connects people to God, to one another, and to the world around them. Worship provides a time and place to think less about ourselves and more about faith, less about our personal agendas, and more about God's activity and will. So today, in the second session of our sermon series, Fruitfulness, we will share about worship service. Let us pray. Almighty God, your word is perfect and your grace is amazing, but your servant is not. So inspire me with the Holy Spirit and open our hearts and minds so that we can listen to your voice together as a group and in family. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing in your sight. O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen. In today's passage, Jesus was traveling with his disciples from Judea to Galilee. You see, the top area, top county was Galilee. The three counties were there at the time. And then Samaria in the middle, and then Judea. Jerusalem was in Judea. And as you see, as you know, the Sea of Galilee was in Galilee. So he was traveling all the way from Judea to Galilee, and most of the Jewish people, all the Jewish people, went around. You know, they didn't want to go through Samaria, but Jesus never mind. He didn't mind at all to walk through Samaria, and then there was an intention for him actually, and he stopped by a town, and he came to a town in Samaria called Sychar, near the plot of ground Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired as he was from the journey, sat down by the well. It was about noon. Noon in Kansas is hot, right? It's hot. And let me tell you, it's similar or hotter in that area during summer or at noon. Now, you see the, let me make it bigger. Okay, here is the Sychar in New Testament, but in Old Testament it is Shechem. As you read the Genesis, book of Genesis, you will find Shechem many times. Jacob's family stopped by there and had a not a good experience, but Shechem has been a very good, important place for the biblical figures at the time. And then he was there, and it was around noon. It was at noon, and he was so thirsty. And when there was a Samaritan woman came out, when a Samaritan woman come to draw water, Jesus said to her, "Will you give me a drink?" This simple question opened and changed many things. So please talk to stranger and with some question, open question. Okay. You can request something, or you can, you know, suggest some offer, some kindness. Talk to somebody you never talk to. Especially if you have anybody in our church you never talk to, please do so. Okay. And this question opened the door. And his disciples had gone into the town to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "You are a Jew and I am a Samaritan woman. How can you ask me for a drink?" For Jews do not associate with Samaritans. So there were two barriers, as you know. Jewish people and Samaritan people, and then men and women. You never talk to other, other than if they are not your family members, you don't talk to other women. But Jesus was talking to that woman, "Will you give me a drink?" And then she was more curious about his question than his request of water. So Jesus answered to her, If you knew the gift of God and who it is that asks you for a drink, you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." So he was introducing himself to her. Okay. Then she was like, "Sir," the woman said, "you have nothing to draw with, and the well is deep." This is Jacob's well, by the way, and Shechem. And this is about 120 feet deep. It is deep, right? So she was wondering, how can you draw the water in this deep well? And where can you get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself, and did also his sons and his livestock? And Jesus answered, "Everyone who drinks the water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks the water I give them will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give them will become in them a spring of water welling up to eternal life." So he was talking about the grace in the Holy Spirit that he was going to provide for those who believe. Right? So he was talking about spiritual way, but she didn't quite get it. So he it was like, you know, the living water was, and written in, he also talked about this living water later. And whoever believes in me, as scripture has said, rivers of living water will flow from within them. And it is also in Revelation, come. And let the one who hears say, come. Let the one who is thirsty come. And let the one who wishes take the free gift of the water of life. So God's grace is given to us for free, because we cannot pay for that. It's given to us for free. That's why it is called grace. And then God, Jesus is providing and suggesting her about this, but she didn't get it yet. So the woman said to him, sir, give me this water so that I won't get thirsty and have to keep coming here to draw water. That'll be very convenient, right? If you have water in your stomach and then, you don't have to come. I don't think she asked this because she was lazy, but because she was not comfortable with coming to the well to draw water. And then, the well at the time was the place, public place that women gather there and the people gather there and then have some stories and gossips and then rumors. So she didn't want to be there, and because of her own story. Now, and then she said that, and he was like, okay. And then he turned his subject to her personal manner. And he said, he told her, go call your husband and come back. And then she said, I have no husband, she replied. Jesus said to her, you're right. When you say you have no husband, the fact is you have had five husbands, and the man you now have is not your husband. What you have just said is quite right, quite true. And then she was surprised. Now, in ancient time, ancient Israel area, women are not allowed to divorce men at the time. That's how the society was working. And instead, men, they divorced their wives. So how many times she had divorced? Five times, right? It's painful experience for her. And then people gossiped about it, and she was not comfortable with it in the public space. That's why she came to draw the water from the well at noon. Nobody comes to draw water at noon. Early in the morning or early evening, when the weather is cool down. But she came to draw water at noon because of her wounds, scars, and her experience, painful experiences. Now, she said, and then when Jesus was talking about her life, and she was so surprised, and she said, sir, the woman said, I can see that you are a prophet. You're not just a Jew, but you're a prophet. And she was so surprised. And then, what are you going to ask if you meet those who know everything about you? You will ask something you have concerned about, or you take it very seriously, right? She asked not about her life or the man who is with her right now. Instead, she asked this question. Our ancestors worshipped on this mountain, but you Jews claim that the place where we must worship is in Jerusalem. Seriously? She was asking Jesus about the worship service. How can we worship? Where is the right place to worship? I would like to worship God properly. Her concern and what matters to her was worshiping God. Where should I worship? By the way, this mountain, Sikar is the town between the mountains. The one mountain is Gerizim, and then the other one is Ebal. And these two, actually not mountains like Rocky Mountains or, you know, like that, but there are hills there, and then Sikar was in the middle. And these two mountains were written in Old Testament as well. When the Lord your God has brought you into the land you are entering to possess, you are to proclaim on Mount Gerizim the blessings and the Mount Ebal the curses. When Moses was teaching the Israelites, when you go into the promised land, proclaim curse in Mount Ebal and praise, proclaim blessings in Mount Gerizim. So follow the Lord, follow God the Lord, worship Him only, then you're going to get blessings. You're going to be blessed. If you follow the idols and if you abandon God, there will be curse for you. So symbolically and as a performance, they stand, you know, in front of the mountains and they proclaimed blessings and curses. And then they promised, we're going to worship God only. We're going to serve and follow God only. Okay. Then Joshua actually did carried out Moses' commands. Then Joshua built on Mount Ebal an altar to the Lord. They worshiped God in there. The God of Israel, as Moses, the several servant of the Lord, has commanded the Israelites. He built it according to what is written in the book of the law of Moses, an altar of uncut stones on which no iron tool had been used. On it they offered to the Lord burnt offerings and sacrificed fellowship offerings. Joshua and the Israelites built an altar on the Mount Ebal and worshiped God. So from then on, they worshiped in these high places. And then she says, our fathers worshiped on this mountain, and you Jews say that in Jerusalem is the place where one ought to worship. And worshiping in the high places has been problematic throughout Jewish history and Israelite history. Before Solomon built the temple of God for the first time, people worshiped God in high places. Even Solomon worshiped God in high place. But that was the practice of the Canaanites. They worshiped Baal and Asherah pole in high places, and they followed that habit. And when they came into the land, they saw the tribes, native tribes, and then, that's how you worship gods. And they followed that. But after Solomon built the temple of God, God ordered them to gather in Jerusalem and worship God. But, you know, it never happened permanently. Solomon, actually, he was corrupted and he built idols in high places. And then when the kingdom was divided into northern kingdom and southern kingdom of Israel, northern kingdom didn't want them to come to Jerusalem to worship. That's going to be politically problematic. So they encouraged people to worship, you know, literally whatever they wanted. So high places, and then places, the altars in Dan and Bethel, they made a golden calf, and then it was messed up. Worshiping God was messed up in Samaria, in northern kingdom of Israel. So that's one of the reasons that the Samaritan people and Jewish people were arguing each other. Where to worship? Where is the perfect, right place to worship? And that was her agenda to figure out. But you know what? Even Jerusalem was designated to worship God. The worship didn't go well. They built idols in the temple of God. They were corrupted. as generations to generations. So God didn't like it at all. So we have to see where is important or how is. And Jesus says like this, "Woman," Jesus replied, "believe me, a time is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. It is not about where, but about how." Not about where, but about how. "Yet a time is coming and has now come when the true worshipers will worship the Father in the Spirit and in truth. For they are the kind of worshipers the Father seeks. Our God is seeking true worshipers who is worshiping God in truth and in spirit. God is spirit, and his worshipers must worship in the spirit and in truth. When we gather to worship God together in this holy place, we set aside this place holy before God and time as well. But the more important thing is our spirit, and we have to worship in spirit and truth. Our heart, how we worship God is more important than where." John Wesley, the founder of Methodism, he worshiped God and preached the gospel in marketplaces, in coal mines, and even in a cemetery and a field to the farmers. He went out to have worship with them, with the common people who couldn't come to the, you know, organize a church building because they had to work. And we have to focus on God, honoring him during the service. The Father is seeking the true worshipers. And then the woman said, "I know the Messiah, called Christ, is coming. When he comes, he will explain everything to us." I know the Messiah is answering. Can you hear her? She was waiting for the Messiah. Besides all the things that are happening in her life. "And then he will explain everything to us." Then Jesus declared, "I, the one speaking to you, I am he. I am he." The Samaritan woman, who was abandoned by five men and then scarred and by the community and wounded, was seeking the true worship and waiting for the Messiah, their Savior, her Savior. That's why Jesus came to her and talk to her. "Give me a drink. Would you please give me a drink?" That question opened this conversation. What will be your opening question or opening conversation with your neighbors or friends or family members to draw them to Christ? Now, she had a concern about worship and then waiting for a Messiah. Now Jesus shared, he is the one. He is the one whom she was waiting for. Now, we have worship in Hillside Nursing Home every month. And then a couple of you join me to worship together. And you know, right? They are so delighted and joyful. And even though they were in wheelchairs and recliners and then they cannot move around, but many of them, maybe half or more, have suffering from dementia. But when we praise the Lord, singing hymns, they sing. They sing together, a loud voice, with harmony even, you know. And then when we recite the Lord's Prayer, they remember that. They remember the Lord's Prayer, reciting all together, and then the atmosphere, the worshiping is true worship that I could feel. And I'm the one who is blessed when we worship together. Even though I'm leading them, you know, I'm the one who is blessed by the Holy Spirit and by them, by their true worship. Worship is not just place. Everywhere we can worship God. When I was in the military service, I was not allowed, one Sunday, I was not allowed to go to church because our superior didn't allow the Sunday to go worship for the particular reason. So I went to by the way, Jim, what is the rank, the one bar, the lowest rank?
First lieutenant. Lieutenant.
No, lieutenant is the officer. I'm talking about the lowest. Maybe PV2? PFC? Yeah, I was PFC. And I had a lower PFC below me. And then two of us went to the Christian corporal. You know, I remember that. Who has a three sticks. You know, I had one. And then I asked him, let us go to church to worship. And then he was like, no, it was forbidden today. And then I was like, we're going to go there and then come back and be beaten up. And then, you know, if they want to beat us, we can be beaten. And then we will be beaten. And then he was like, okay, you can be beaten up. You will be beaten up. But what about if they beat up everybody in the barracks because of both of you? And I was like, we were hesitating to answer, oh, that's not good, right? So God gave him a wisdom that, okay, let us worship, three of us in the bus at night after the sleeping time. And you know, the bus was located, you know, next to our barracks. So then he said, you're a seminarian, so prepare a sermon. He gave me a task. And from then on, I prepared a sermon in the restroom because I was not allowed to read anything. Books or anything, because I was the lowest one. In the restroom or storage room and then in a garbage area, I sneaked in and then I read the Bible and then took a note to prepare the sermon. Then at night, after the sleeping time, everybody went to bed. The lights were turned off. And the three of us were sneaking out quietly to the next barracks, and then there was a bus, and we sneaked in. We gathered with a flashlight and then read a Bible scripture passage and then shared. God gave me the word, the scripture, Daniel chapter 3, verses 16 through 18. Daniel's three friends, they had faith and then they were thrown into the fire, but they didn't give up their faith. So we shared that faith, and then no matter what happens, let us keep our faith. That was the main idea of the sermon. And then we had a fellowship with snacks, and then sneaked in again. And the following Sunday, I was overjoyed to go to worship together. And you know what? When we enter into the church building, they were praising God, and I was like, we were, you know, shedding tears and then with joy and then blessings. Do you know what the pastor, the chaplain, came up and then what was the passage that he shared with us? Daniel chapter 3, verses 16 through 18. Can you imagine that? And we were like, God listened and then received the worship. Even I was not a pastor. I was young, 19 years old, or 20 years old I was. But we had worship in a bus at night, secretly. But God listened and received our worship. We shed tears with joy and overwhelming blessings upon us, overwhelming grace upon us. This doesn't matter. But we have this beautiful house of worship. Why can't we worship God with truth and the Spirit? Because we have everything. We have family of faith. We have all kinds of equipment we can listen to. We have Bible. We have things and a great musician here, Shelley. So whenever we worship God together, let us worship in spirit and truth. God will listen to us. And then the bishop in his book shared like this. Oh, by the way, the woman, after he found out Jesus was the Messiah, leaving her water jar. The water jar wasn't, you know, she didn't matter about the jar. And then the woman went back to the town and said to the people, "Come, see a man who told me everything I ever did. Could this be the Messiah?" And she shared the, proclaimed about Jesus, and then many people in town came to see Jesus, and they learned, and they were taught, they listened to the gospel from Jesus. God is seeking the true worshipers, friends. The bishop Sinead says, God uses worship to transform lives, heal wounded souls, renew hope, shape decisions, provoke change, inspire compassion, bind people to one another, and prepare them to serve their neighbors. Maybe it's so to each one of you and all of us. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for gathering us to worship you. Lord, please make us true worshipers so that we can seek you and honor you and praise you, so that this worship can be extended to our lives, walking with you every day. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen. Let us give our gift to the Lord.
Stand as you're able, face the cross as we sing the doxology.
God, with humility we offer our tithes and offerings to you. May they be used to faithfully serve the mission and ministry of your holy church. Bless those who offer to you with gratitude. Fill their needs, watch over their path every day. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. Do we have any birthday boys or girls? Okay. Jubilee? It's your birthday? Okay, we're gonna sing for you. Please stand.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Jubilee. Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday, Jubilee. Do you have any good news to share? Thank you, Alice. So, now you can jump. Can you jump now? Okay, good, good, good. Okay. Yeah, she was injured, and thank you for providing her food and a card and then phone calls and your care. Thank you so much. That's what the family of faith meant to be. Right? Thank you so much. And yesterday and Friday, Sue and Shelley and Linda, Linda Patton, okay. Shelley Field, yeah. Sue Holsider. And four of us participated in the congregational care ministry, ministers seminar. Okay. So we learned so many things. And hopefully God will open doors for us to more ministry for this matter. Okay. Now let us praise our Lord through hymn number 77, How Great Thou Art. We're going to sing verses 1 and 4. Going forth holding this amazing good news of Jesus Christ, may the grace of the Lord Jesus and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit equip you and inspire you and be with you all forever and ever. Amen. Go in peace, my brothers and sisters. Amen.